Welcome to Church This Way.
Thank you.
It's a beautiful day out there, we're doing lucky. The peace of the Lord is on you.
And also be with you.
This morning's shepherd love, I think the words are gonna be on the wall. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the God of manna, the God of miracles. Amen. Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, let us confess our sin. God, our provider, help us. It is hard to believe that there's enough to share. We question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life and lead us for life in the world.
Amen.
Beloved people of God, in Jesus the man from heaven, you are fed and nourished. By Jesus, the worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus, the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy. And you are forgiven and loved into abundant life.
Amen.
Gracious God,
you have placed within the hearts of all your children a longing for your word and a hunger for your truth. Grant that we may know your Son, see the true bread of heaven, and share this bread with all the world. In Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Oh,
Morning.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
First reading for today is 2 Kings 4:42-44. A man came from Baal Shalisha, bringing food from the first fruits to Elijah, the man of God. 20 loaves of barley and fresh ears of grain in his sack. Elijah said, "Give it to the people and let them eat." But his servant said, "How can I send this to 400 people?" So he repeated, "Give it to the people and let them eat, for thus says the Lord, they shall eat and have some left." He set it before them, they ate, and they had some left, according to the word of the Lord. Our next is Psalms 145, verses 10-18, read responsibly. All your works shall praise you, O Lord, and your faithful ones shall bless you.
You shall tell of the glory of your kingdom and speak of your power.
That all people may know your power and the glorious splendor of the kingdom.
For your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom. Your dominion endures throughout all ages. You, Lord, are faithful in all your words and loving in all your works.
The Lord upholds all those who fall and lifts up those who are bowed down.
Our eyes fall away upon you, O Lord, and you give them their food in due season.
You open wide your hand and satisfy the desire of every living thing.
You are righteous in all your ways and loving in all your works. You are near to all who call upon you. To all who call upon you, they would.
Our second reading is from Ephesians 3, verses 14-21. For this reason, I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth faces him. I pray that, according to the riches of this glory, he may grant that you may be strengthened in your inner being with power through his Spirit. And that Christ can dwell in your hearts through faith, as you are being rooted and grounded in love. I pray that you may have the power to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, so that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who by the power at work within us is able to accomplish abundantly far more than all we can ask for a man. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel of the Lord.
Gospel for the Sunday from the 6th chapter of the Gospel according to St. John. Gospel for the Sunday from the 6th chapter of the Gospel according to St. John. Sometime after this, Jesus crossed to the far shore of the Sea of Galilee, that is, the Sea of Tiberias. And a great crowd of people followed him because they saw the signs he had performed by healing the sick. Then Jesus went up on a mountainside and sat down with his disciples. The Jewish Passover festival was near. When Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming toward him, he said to Philip, "Where should we buy bread for these people to eat?" He asked this only to test it, for he already had in mind what he was going to do. Philip answered him, "It would take more than a half year's wages to buy enough bread for each one to have a bite." Another of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up. "Here is a boy with 5 small barley loaves and 2 small fish. But how far will they go among so many?" Jesus said, "Have the people sit down." There was plenty of grass in that area, so they sat down. About 5,000 men were there. Jesus then took the loaves, gave thanks, and distributed to those who were seated as much as they wanted. He did the same with the fish. When they had all had enough to eat, he said to his disciples, gather the pieces that are left over, and let nothing be wasted. So they gathered them and filled 12 baskets with the pieces of bread, barley loaves that were left over by those who had eaten. After people saw the sign that Jesus performed, they began to say, surely this is the prophet who is to come into the world. Jesus, knowing that they intended to come and make him king by force, withdrew again to a mountain by himself. When evening came, his disciples went down to the sea, got into a boat, and started across the sea to Capernaum. It was now dark, and Jesus had not yet come to them. The sea became rough because a strong wind was blowing. When they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the sea and coming near the boat. And they were terrified. But he said to them, it is I, do not be afraid. Then they wanted to take him into the boat. And immediately the boat reached the land toward which they were going. Gospel of the Lord. Grace and peace be from God, the Creator, and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It's good to be with you this morning. Greetings to all of you in the 88 congregations and ministries of the Southwestern Washington Synod. We're gathered here to worship today, all in a whole synod that starts down the Columbia River and goes up the Olympic Peninsula of Canada and goes from the Cascade Mountains out to the Pacific. So we're gathered together by the Holy Spirit today, and it's good to be with you here at sermon time. From the very beginning of the Christian church, this story we just read in the gospel, the story of Jesus feeding the 5,000, has been one of the most popular and meaningful stories in all of the events described in the gospels. In fact, it's such a central story that it's the only miracle story done by Jesus that is reported in all 4 gospels. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John all insisted that the story of Jesus feeding the 5,000 be found in their gospel. And for us today, it continues to be a crucial story because it also is such a vital example, such an energetic example of how Jesus comes to bring us life. Life for our physical bodies, life for our spirits, life for our relationships, life for our communities. Jesus is the one who comes to feed us and to bring us life. When we read the 4 Gospels, we see that Jesus brings God's love and life to people in a variety of ways. Another way of saying that is that Jesus took different roles. He lived out God's love in a variety of ways. Jesus was a teacher, so he taught people about the love of God so that they could know that they were God's beloved. Jesus was a healer. He healed those who were sick. He touched the lepers. He brought them God's life in a physical, medical way. Jesus was a peacemaker. When 2 of his disciples were fighting about who was going to get what share of their father's inheritance, Jesus sat them down and had them work out their differences. Or when the Samaritans and the Jewish people were getting along, Jesus was able to show how they were all part of God's family. At the second part of our gospel lesson for today, when the disciples were out on the sea of the storm, Jesus was the one who came to calm the storm, to calm the chaos. And so there are a variety of ways, of roles in which Jesus lived out God's grace, lived out God's love, lived out God's justice. However, this image that we have in the gospel lesson today of Jesus being the one who feeds the hungry, that's a central way in which Jesus so immediately expresses to people that they are God's dear ones and that they are part of God's beloved family. And so Jesus, later on in chapter 6, after our gospel lesson for today, he says, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry. When we look around us in the world, there's a lot of ways in which people are hungry. And so the question that these texts put to us today, when we're reading them, they put to us the question, how are you hungry today? What's the ways in which you're feeling empty? And when you look at the people around you in the neighborhood, who are the hungry people around you, and what are they hungry for? And, as Jesus asked his disciples, question also is, how are you going to feed them? If you're a follower of me, says Jesus, if you're going to be doing what I'm doing, how are you going to feed these hungry people in all the ways in which they're hungry? When I first graduated from seminary and went to serve my first church, I was called to serve the St. John Lutheran Church in San Diego, St. Mary and St. Martha Lutheran Church in San Francisco. And my ministry was to the Spanish-speaking community in the Mission District of San Francisco. It's like this for the first 100 years of my ministry. So at the other end of the Mission District, so we were in the, kind of the middle of the Mission District, the other end of the Mission District was St. Matthew Lutheran Church that served the German Lutheran community in San Francisco and that whole area. So I was working with Spanish-speaking people. The pastor at St. Matthew's, Kurt Edelsberger, who became a good friend of mine, worked with the German-speaking population because even from all over the area, they still go to church services in German on Sunday morning. And one day, as we were talking, Kurt Edelsberger told me his life story and how he came to be a Lutheran pastor. Kurt grew up as a young boy during the time of World War II in Germany. His family was German. And when the war ended in 1945, Kurt was 13 years old, but he had lost everything. His entire family had been killed in the fighting. His village that he lived in had been severely bombed. And so his parents, his brothers and sisters, his aunts and uncles all died. He didn't have a place to live because his house had been blown up. And so all of a sudden he found himself in the world completely alone. He didn't have a penny in his pocket. And so he began to travel around from nearby village to village, looking for a place to sleep, looking for some food to eat. But those villages were also destroyed and people didn't have extra food to feed them. And so a week went by without him having anything to eat. And then 2 weeks went by without him having anything to eat. And at this point, he could barely walk, he could barely stay awake. And then almost 3 weeks went by without him having anything to eat. And that night, he found some shelter in a bombed out railroad station. No one was there. There was the roof was wide open. There were some wooden benches in the railroad station. And he remembers laying down on one of those benches and saying to himself, I'm going to die tonight. I just can't go on. I'm going to die tonight. So he kind of went off into a slumber, almost a semi-coma. During the night, two soldiers came into the railroad station. They happened to be two American soldiers. That part of Germany was being overseen by the American Allied forces after the war was over. So two soldiers come in, and they see this totally emaciated, gaunt 13-year-old boy laying on a bench. And they gently tapped him on the shoulder. They tried to talk to him. They could tell that he was just in a very miserable condition. One of the soldiers reached into his day pack and brought out a nice big piece of bread. And he gave the bread to Kurt. And Kurt took a taste of the bread. He thought it was a dream at first. Couldn't believe he was actually eating something. But he received that bread, and he knew in that moment that he was going to die, and this was the gift of life. They had given him the gift of life. But the generosity and care of the soldiers didn't stop there. They knew that just giving a 13-year-old boy a piece of bread when he didn't have any other community or family around him wasn't going to be enough. So they knew that nearby that station was a refugee camp set up by the Allied forces that particularly cared for children and young people who had no family left to be cared for. So that night, they took Kurt over to that refugee center. And he stayed there for 3 months. And the staff at the refugee center were wonderful. They cared for the children, they fed them, they provided warm tents for them to sleep in. They were very kind and considerate towards the children. But as they began to help children find a better place to live or a family to live with, they realized that with Kurt, that there was no good options for him. He didn't have, he literally didn't have any family left alive in Germany. Didn't have friends who could take him in. And so, with Kurt's agreement, they sent him off by boat to Canada, where he went to Saskatoon, Canada, and became part of a Lutheran orphanage there in Saskatoon. Just like in the United States, Lutheran Immigration and Refugee Service, that many of you are familiar with, operated in the United States, so the Lutheran Church in Canada also had an Immigration and Refugee Service for so many people coming out of all of Europe who had lost everything in the war. Well, Kurt went to this Lutheran orphanage, this Lutheran Refugee Service. Some of the children were being adopted out, but Kurt decided he didn't want to just all of a sudden start off over at age 14 with a new family. So he stayed in the orphanage, and he became one of the older children who helped out the other kids and helped run the food kitchen during the day. Well, he stayed there. He lived there for 4 years until he graduated from high school in Saskatoon. Then he attended a Lutheran college in Saskatoon. And after he got his four-year bachelor's degree, he enrolled in a Lutheran seminary in Saskatoon and became a Lutheran pastor in the Church of Canada. He served a couple congregations there, but then received a call to St. Matthew Lutheran Church in San Francisco, who also wanted a pastor who would speak both German and English to that ministry. When Kurt had told me that whole story, he said to me, "There is not a day that goes by that I don't remember those two soldiers giving me that piece of bread. There's not a day that goes by that I can't still taste that bread, because I knew it was the gift of life. I was tasting the life that had been given back." Jesus sees the crowds of people coming towards him, apparently people who have been traveling all day or waiting to listen to Jesus. He knows they're hungry. And he says to Philip, the disciple nearest to him, he said, "Where are we going to find bread for all these people?" We look around us in the world and we see so many people who are hungry in different ways. We see people who literally are physically hungry for bread. They need food. They're on the verge of death. The United Nations has reported that there are 800 million people in the world who are living severely malnourished. And so there are people who are hungry for food, for physical food. We also look around us in our own town, in our own congregation, in our own neighborhood, and we see people who are lonely. They're hungry for relationships. There are people who feel an empty place in their lives because they don't have friends. We see other people in the world today who are scared. The world can be a very scary place. So there are people who are hungry for safety, who need to feel like they have a community around them that cares for them. And then we see people in the world, and sometimes we experience this ourselves when we find that we're hungry for some meaning, some purpose in our life. We've come to a certain point in our life where we feel like we just haven't done enough, but we've done enough for our lives. So we feel an empty place where we want to know, what's our life for? What are we doing here? And so we can be hungry in all kinds of ways. And Jesus knows that. And so he says to his disciples, and today he says to us, "Where are you going to find some bread to feed people? Where are you going to find the bread that feeds your own hunger? But how are you going to find the bread that feeds the people around you?" This weekend, as I'm here talking to you online, on this Sunday, I'm preaching in person at St. John Lutheran Church in Lakewood, just on the edge of Tacoma. If you drive by St. John's, right there on their signboard, it says, "St. John Lutheran Church, fed and feeding." And if you go to their website, right on the first page of their website, is a photograph of a beautiful loaf of baked bread. I just want to eat it right there. And underneath it says again, "St. John Lutheran, fed and feeding." And what this connects with is that when we're hungry, Jesus feeds us. When we are hungry, Jesus is committed by the power of the Holy Spirit to come to us, but also to energize us as a community, to feed one another, to care one another, so that we can know that we are God's dear ones. And then, as we are fed by Christ, we get the energy, we get the power to go out and feed others who are hungry. We are fed and we are feeding. That's what we do. And that's what you're doing in your churches. I know that your congregations are all involved in that process of feeding people. And again, feeding people in all the different ways that we need that, spiritually and emotionally. And so when you gather people for worship, you are feeding people spiritually. You are feeding them with the love of God. When you gather people, when you sing together, it's the music that feeds us. It's the Holy Spirit coming to us through the music that feeds us. When you go to Holy Communion, think about that later on in service today. When you go up to Holy Communion, when you eat the bread and wine, you are literally being fed by the very presence of Christ. Christ comes to feed you. And then when you have Bible study, you're feeding people with the Word of God. Or when you visit people, you are feeding them with friendship. We are feeding people in all kinds of ways in our congregations, including, I know in your congregations, you are also, many of you are literally feeding people with food. The ELC, our national church body, did some research, and they discovered that 95% of the congregations in the ELCA are feeding people with real food in some way, either through providing a community meal once a week when people from the neighborhood are invited in, or you participate in a food pantry, you have on your church, or you donate food to a local fish house or food pantry, or you team up with other churches and agencies around you in order to feed people more systematically in your neighborhood. St. John Lutheran, where I'm preaching on this Sunday, has a program called Bridgeport Community Connections, in which they've done exactly that. They've teamed up with the agencies and churches around them to care about people who are hungry. And so you feed all kinds of people, including with actual food. And a lot of you also make financial contributions to ELCA World Hunger. That's the arm of our church that feeds people around the world, feeds people here in the United States and around the world, with direct food in an emergency situation, or feeds people by going to places and teaching better farming techniques for farmers so that they can grow bigger crops to feed their family, but also sell it as a profit and be able to send their kids to school. Or ELC World Hunger also works to help organize community projects or local governments to do a better job of caring for people, or they work on better land redistribution. So ELC World Hunger, by direct food and better farming techniques, feeds literally millions of people around the world. And in our synod, just last year in 2020, 34 congregations, 34 of you who I'm talking to today, made contributions to ELC World Hunger of almost $340,000. So 34 congregations contributed an average of $10,000 a piece. So just from our synod, we sent $340,000 to ELCA World Hunger so that people could eat, so that people could grow food, so that people could have decent lives. I am the bread of life, said Jesus. I come to feed you in all ways in which you feel empty, all ways in which you feel hungry, hungry in your stomach, hungry in your spirit, hungry for relationships, hungry for peace in your neighborhoods. Jesus says, I come to feed you. Now you go full of that good food. You go and feed others in my name. Amen.
months of labor. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. Please. I believe in God, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He ascended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Rooted in Christ and sustained by the Spirit, we offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all of creation. We pray for the church. Bless the ministries of our neighboring congregations. Empower churches throughout the world and encourage missionaries to accompany global neighbors. Kindle in us the spirit of collaboration, that all people may know your loving works. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for creation. Send rain to lands experiencing drought and come to the aid of those enduring sweltering heat. Nurture wheat and barley crops grown for the nourishment of your people, and conserve aquatic habitats and fish populations. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for those who govern. Cast out arrogance, selfishness, and corruption, and instruct those who lead to practice compassion and humility. Inspire them with a vision of the common good and a commitment to ensure that all who hunger are fed. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for those bowed down by heavy burdens, those who are unemployed or underemployed, those unable to find affordable housing, and those without health insurance. Console those who grieve, hear the cries of those who call to you for healing, especially the Tactico family, Gilchrist family, Anna Zimmerman, Nancy Ballberger, Custer family, Thibodeau family, Dwayne Scott, Pat Gansler, Kristen Croy, and Dana Hughes. Hear us, O God. We pray for this assembly. Deepen our resolve to use what we have to serve those in need. When we worry that we do not have enough resources for ministry, assure us of your abundance. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We give thanks for those who have died. As you sustain them through all their days, so dwell in our hearts that we may have the power to comprehend with all the saints the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We lift these and all our prayers to you, O God, confident in the promise of your saving love, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
So I think due to our touch points, the offering plates are in the back. So yeah, so we're not going to pass the plates, but they are there and so they're available to you. So as the body of believers and community, Christ, let's do that. And saying that we're all together. a beautiful prayer and praise.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures truly know. Praise Him above the heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Jesus, bread of life, you have set us table with your very self and called us to the feast of plenty. Gather what has been sown among us and strengthen us in this meal. Make us to be what we receive here, your body for the life of the world.
Amen.
As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim our Lord's death until he comes again.
Christ
is high.
Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
All are welcome to the Lord's table. You do not need to be a member of this church or our denomination to commune with us. At home, we invite you during this time to feel the Spirit's presence. Enjoy the entire body of Christ together. You may use bread and wine or juice or water. You may also choose to fast from communion today. Hear this blessing. You belong to God. You are loved. You are not alone. Amen. In-house, the communion elements will be blessed and placed in the back of the sanctuary for you to receive as you leave. Jesus, bread of life, we receive from your table more than we could ever ask. As you nourish us in this meal, strengthen us to love the world with your own life. In your name, we pray.
Amen.
The blessing of God who provides for us, feeds us, and journeys with us, be upon you now and forever.
Amen.
So this song we've done before, but it's been a while, okay? So could we recognize the PowerPoint in there? Lean forward to this chorus. Can you do that? So I'd like to run through one more time this chorus for sure. The verses are a little trickier, but if we can get the chorus down and sing that together, that would be really great. So like I said, we've done it before, but it's been a number of years. So I'll just run it together and see what happens. There you go, it sounds like this.
Thank you.
good morning. We have lots of people traveling on vacations and camping and doing all kinds of fun things this week. So it's good to see some of you here. A special reminder that our congregational meeting is this Tuesday night at 5 o'clock. And I will open, God willing, the Zoom meeting at 4:45 for your participation. So please be there. We need a forum in order to sell our strip of property. If you have questions about it, Bob Wilson is in the back today and we'd be happy to answer your questions. Family Promise just sent out a newsletter that indicated they are going to continue to keep families in their venue center, and they are going to add on another room so that they can have another full family. So if you are feeling like second round giving, that would be an opportunity to support Family Promise as they continue their service. They also will be continuing to have people bring meals to the center, and we need a liaison that will help us connect to that. So if you'd be willing to, once every 6 weeks, be the person that asks for any volunteers and dinners, please let me know. We'd be love to have you do that. Start collecting backpack supplies and back to school supplies if you are willing. As we get into late August, we will do an all call for any gathering of those to be taken to our new Lexington school and to our neighbor here next door. Also in September, we will do an in gathering of Ziploc bags for emergency supplies for the homeless. So you recall all the kinds of things we put in them in the past. So as you see sales or go to Costco or somewhere, please consider starting to gather those at your house. And we'll let you know when that in gathering is going to be. Ziploc bags. And you don't have to do the bag of just gather supplies, and then we'll do a thing where we put on gloves and we'll fill the bags. The prayer chain good news is that we have Shelley Lindbeck has agreed to be our prayer chain provider. I think that's going to start September. And Chris Cotton will team with her, so when one is traveling, the other can help. And finally, Love Overwhelming is still looking for support for those who are homeless, and that full information is in your bulletin. And Ari, you have an announcement?
For the in-gathering of supplies for the homeless, will there be a list put out of needs?
As we get closer, I will do that. But for the homeless, we're looking for everything from toothpaste, toothbrush, band-aid, soap, shampoo, anything that you can think of that if you were without your home and struggling in an emergency that you can use. Anything else? Let's give our sister Karen a big thank you for bringing another good week to us. May the Lord bless and keep you. You are the body of Christ.
Thank you, God.